Kirby J. Pilato. We're pleased to have you again. Yay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello. Kirby. That brought me back. Thank you, Brett. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the, what is the third episode of the second season of Throwback Thursdays, which we began in the summer of 2015, which was really just a couple months ago. And it was only supposed to be a pilot. Actually, it wasn't a pilot program. It was just a special program. And it became so popular that we decided to continue it. And we have a wonderful guests this evening. But in the future, we have Don Wells from Gilligan's Island, and Anson Williams from Happy Days, and Kathy Coleman from Land of the Lost, that great Saturday morning show, Kathy Garver from Family Affairs. So please come back every week for these guests and sometimes some special guests that have not been announced but who will just appear. It's a co-presentation of the Classic TV Preservation Society, which is my nonprofit organization, the 501c3. Which is dedicated to the positive influence of classic television. And tonight we are going to be focusing on The Doris Day Show, which is one of my favorite shows of all time. And it was just one of the coziest TV shows in the history of television, is the way I look at it. And we have three very special guests. I'm going to be interviewing them one at a time. And then at the end of the evening, we will all return here to these seats and we'll do a Q&A. With all of you, and then Patrick will be signing his book. Will be signing his book, The Doris Day Companion, and I will also be signing my books, Touch Upon a Star, The Elizabeth Montgomery, The Bewitched Life of Elizabeth Montgomery, and The Essential Elizabeth Montgomery, which is an encyclopedia of her work, as well as Glamour Gidgets and The Girl Next Door, which does a profile. It has a profile of every girl. Classic TV female from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, as well as Life Goes On. Remember that show that was on in the 90s starring Patti LuPone and Chris Burke, who has Down syndrome, becoming the first regular weekly character on TV who had a disability. Without further ado, we are going to start this show with Mr. Pierre Patrick, who wrote this incredible book about The Doris Day Show, which again is one of my favorite shows, and it's just I'm just so delighted that he did the book, and I'm certain that he has wonderful stories to share with us and a wonderful insight about that program, which is really one of the most unique shows too in the history of TV, and that's what we're going to talk about right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Pierre Patrick. Hi, Pierre, how are you? Why don't you pick up that mic right over there?
Okay.
And you got to talk into it.
Like, hello. There you go.
Yes.
How you doing?
Very good. How are you? So nice. So nice to meet you.
No, it's really nice for you to have me. This is really, really cool. So everybody looks really happy and curious, which is always good.
Well, happy is the really motto of, yes, of Throwback Thursdays here in Burbank. Happy and positive things. So, now tell us a little bit about you first, and then how you came to actually become interested in The Doris Day Show and how the book happened. Let's start with a little bit about your background.
Okay, well, I've always loved Doris Day since I was a kid. And, you know, I moved to LA when I was 15 and basically just made myself into the entertainment industry and kind of did all kinds of project music and everything. Eventually I got a Grammy nomination, but I didn't win. And
what was that for?
It was for an album I produced called The Christmas That Almost Wasn't with John Lithgow. And it was written by Ogden Nash and tons of stars, Billy Crawford and people from Boy Meets World, a couple of groups from Transcontinental. So that was really cool to do. And I worked on some television shows and movies, and now I'm at the Jerry Pace Agency, kind of running that. And yes, there you go. And it's a wonderful agency. We're merging actually 10 agencies together, and it's expanding, and it's great, and always looking for new talent. And so, but to go back to Doris Day, I've always loved Doris Day. And I moved to LA when I was really young, and when I moved here, Doris Day, I just moved to Carmel. So I basically missed her completely. So in 1989,
she lives in Carmel.
She lives in Carmel. So in 1989, she was coming to LA, and she was going to get the Cecil B. DeMille Award at the Golden Globe Awards. So I found out the day before, and I called the Golden Globes, and I had to go because it was Doris Day. It was the only time she was coming in town. I think I was about 17 at the time. So I couldn't get a ticket to the Golden Globe at all. They just were not going to let me in. So I said, I got to go anyway. So I lived in Westwood. My parents had given me a Hugo Boss tuxedo for Christmas. So I put the tuxedo on. I walked to the Beverly Hilton. And then I got in, and there was a table and everything. And you know, you go in, and all the doors are open, and everybody's walking in. And you do the old, hi, Bob. And then, of course, somebody turns around.
Right,
you know.
Yeah.
So I walked in, and I was prepared. So I had my Doris Day picture, and I walked straight to her table, and she was with this guy, Clint Eastwood. Anyway, so basically, I walked in, and I went to her, and then I showed her this picture, and I met her for the first time. She was so beautiful, and all dressed in white, and she was really, really terrific. And she loved the picture, and she showed it to everybody. Alan Carr was there, and her Terry, her son, and Jacqueline, his wife at the time, and it was just really cool, and I spent a few minutes, but then I didn't want to leave the room. And you know, if you guys ever gone to the Golden Globes, it's all divided by shows. So you have every show as a table, or the movie as a table. So you really can't find a seat. So I went to this table for a show called Dallas. And so I was sitting there, there was Larry Hagman and all those people, and there was two seats on the back. So I sat in one of those, and they're looking at me, they don't know who I am. So I'm eating my salad. And then two girls, they were twins, they were on that show. So they came in and sat there. And so, oh my God, I'm in the wrong seat. What's the matter with me? So then I started walking around the room. And then Jimmy Smith, you know him?
Yeah.
From LA Law, he had a show at the time. He says, hey kid, what are you doing? And I said, I'm gonna be really honest. I said, well, I'm really here for Doris Day. He goes, really? He says, yeah, I love Doris Day. This is so cool. I said, really? He says, my God, that's like unbelievable. So he goes, I'm gonna get a chair and a dinner for you. So he put me at the LA Law table. I had dinner with him and a show, and then I got to see Doris at the end and the Merv Griffin party and everything. And fast forward to last year, I was in church in Brentwood, and Jimmy Smith was there. So at the end of the mass, I went to talk to him, and I said, you know, we had dinner together in 1989. You may not remember this. He says, so I told him the Golden Globes. So were you with that little kid? I said, that was me. He said, oh my God, and now I know Doris, and we became friends throughout the years. So, oh my God, that's like unbelievable. And he introduced me to his father-in-law, who was 91. So, but anyway, that was my first experience of meeting Doris. This was a long story, wasn't it?
No, it's a good story. Those are the good stories.
Oh, okay. Okay. No, I mean, I'm like going on and on.
No, I like those stories. So, but at what point did you then say, you know, I want to write a book? Did you always have that in the back of your head?
Well, I got a job writing for a magazine called Television Chronicle. Sure. You may remember that magazine.
I remember that.
So,
they did a nice
review of my Bewitched Forever book.
There you go. So great magazine, and that I wish the magazine was big. It was so good and specific about television. So I wanted my first story to be about Doris Day. And you know Doris Day doesn't do any interviews. So I decided I'm going to try it anyway. So I started interviewing co-stars and sending her cassettes of the interviews by mail. Mm. And she listened to them and she liked them. Mm. And then finally on Mother's Day, she decided to do an interview with me for the magazine. So and we talked for more than an hour. She really liked me. She invited me to Carmel. She gave me a dog. I mean, it was really cool, you know? I mean, it was just like all this stuff happened. It was just terrific. And then I started going to Carmel and having lunches and going to the house. And
Clint Eastwood was there too at some point because he's in Carmel.
Yeah, he's their next door neighbor, but who cares? But anyway, Doris was always so gracious.
You realize we're taping this. Okay, go.
That's all right. So it's Doris Day. So, but basically, yeah, she was always so gracious and nice, and even when I went to visit, my dog always came to the restaurant with us, and her dogs would stay in the car. She would mainly talk to the manager. My dog fell in love with me like crazy. So, I have some wonderful experience and dinners and lunches, and she's just been amazing. And you know, I've been really lucky. I've worked with Shirley Jones and Debbie Reynolds and Mickey Rooney and all those cool people, but there's something about Doris that's just really magic.
What is it?
I don't know. I think there's an essence and an aura about her. And she's so gracious and wonderful. It's like when you meet certain movie stars, they're cool, they're fun, they're kind of the same. With Doris, there's a certain, I don't know, it's just something
sincerity.
Really. Yeah, and like an aura, magic about her that's like really amazing, you know? I mean, she's just so wonderful. And she's very selective who she talks to and friends that she has and everything. And for good reason, because, you know, there's been some bad experience and the press sometimes haven't been, you know, they photograph her in horrible places and mm-hmm. they do all. But right now, she's been really in charge of her career. She releases new photos when she wants to. And she's very involved with the Animal Foundation, the hotel, the Cypress Inn. And very active with all that she's doing, you know.
You know, we had Jackie Joseph on the show a couple weeks ago.
And Jackie wrote the foreword to my book.
Oh, there you go. Well, yeah, we were going to try and get
terrific.
Her here tonight, but
she's traveling.
She's traveling.
Yeah. But when we released the book, the first book, Que Sera Sera, Jackie was there, and Rosemarie, and Doris called. And she talked to everybody in the bookstore, which was really, really nice.
So this is the second
That's
book?
That's the second version of that book. It's
okay.
A deeper interview. We did a lot of stuff with her movies, and all her albums are included, so there's a little more of her career.
So it's not just about the
show.
It's
all the films are included. And
which,
and
my favorite is Send Me No Flowers.
That's my
favorite Doris Day movie, Doris Day Rock Hudson movie.
Yeah,
actually.
If you read some of the DVDs, sometimes I do the audio commentary. I did Caprice with Richard Harris, so if you want.
Now, was some talk that they were going to do one more?
You know, they
film?
Talked about it. They were going to do one maybe in 85. There was a script written. Christy McNichol was supposed to play their daughter. But Doris became very picky and selective. You know, if it wasn't perfect and if it wasn't great, she really wasn't interested in making a comeback. ABC made a huge offer for her to do The Widow's Club. And it was supposed to be a mystery movie kind of a thing. And
you mean like a semi-regular show?
They gave her script approval. She never approved of any script. So, but that's Doris Day. You know, she can do whatever she wants. You know, she worked for 50 years. She was the number one box office film star of all time. Still is. That record hasn't been broken for women. She recorded 1,200 songs, and had 76 charted hits. No other woman has ever done that. Well, people forget all that, so, you know. And when she got the Lifetime Achievement Award at the Grammys, at the 50th Grammy Award.
Yeah, what year was that again?
It was, we're at the 57th right now. So about 7 years ago. So it was really cool to bring it to Carmel, and there's a photo of that. And it's just, you know, and that's an award she really likes and appreciates. I know the Academy Award refuses to give her one, and that's ridiculous. But,
and they're giving, I think, three different honorary Oscars or something this year, aren't
Yeah, they're
they?
Giving it to Gina Rowlands.
Okay.
So I didn't hear any applause at all. You know, Gina Rowlands, it's Doris Day. So, you know, it's like, okay. Gina Rowlands is great, but, you know, there's Debbie Reynolds is getting one for her charity work, which is great, so she's going to get that, and Debbie's terrific. So, So there you go.
Doris was well liked within the industry.
Yeah, everybody liked Doris Day. I mean, everybody that worked with her liked her and loved her. You know, it's like Marilyn Monroe and Doris Day were working pretty much at the same time. And I did a documentary called Doris Day versus Marilyn Monroe, which is on Fox. And we compare Marilyn and Doris doing the exact same scene from the same movie.
Right.
And it's really interesting to see the difference in the way they acted. You know, Marilyn Monroe studied in New York to become a better actress, and she was even worse after that.
I think I saw some of that on the extras.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
Exactly. And Marilyn was tough to work with and not focus on her career or lines and everything. And you know, when you work on a film, and maybe some of you guys know, you have to be there. You have to be on time. It's all. But at that time, you know, Doris was worked so much. She was recording in the morning. Go to the film studio, get makeup, no break for lunch, you had to go back to the recording studio. She only had Sundays off, and she had to learn her songs and the script for the following week. And she didn't have an earplug for her lines, and she didn't have a teleprompter.
And she was, she never had an acting lesson
either.
I mean, she was a natural,
exactly.
Yes?
Exactly. I mean, her, Frank Sinatra, so many great people you know, never study. And you know, LA is the number one place for acting schools. I mean, if you turn around, there's an acting school all around here, you know, so there's more acting school than actors. So I know, because as an agent, I go to a lot of acting schools, and the stars of the acting schools are always the acting teacher. So, which I find kind of interesting. I'm sure yours was very good. So
what is your favorite Doris Day movie, and why?
You know, it's really hard. Love Me or Leave Me is great.
That's my favorite.
Yeah, you know, it's an amazing film. The Man Who Knew Too Much is great.
Okay, talk a little bit about that film. What is it for those?
Well, Love Me or Leave Me is with James Cagney, and you're falling asleep, aren't you? So basically, Love Me or Leave Me is James Cagney plays her manager, also named Marty, like her husband was her manager. It's the real story. Ruth Etting was a very big singer in the 20s. And Doris played a part that was different. She was drinking, her life was tough, she was raped, and she kept on doing her career. And it's just an excellent film. It was her first movie with MGM.
And was that her favorite?
No, her favorite is Calamity Jane to this day.
Really?
Yeah.
I thought there was one really heavy-duty role that she did. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I mean, she liked it. The Man Who Knew Too Much, she really loved the Hitchcock film. One of my favorite also is My Dream Is Yours, which is her second film, because it's Doris raising a son with no husband. It's kind of her life story. She becomes a big star on the radio. Jack Carson was her co-star. And there's so many songs in there, and it kind of follows her life at the time, plus Bugs Bunny's in it, which is really cool.
Cool.
So I love Caprice, that's why I did the audio commentary on it. She plays a real spy, it's like the James Bond kind of a thing, which was really fun. And I don't think there's really a bad Doris Day movie. One that's a little known is Storm Warning, because it's the only time that Doris Day died. And she gets killed by the Ku Klux Klan. It's a heavy drama. And Ronald Reagan plays the district attorney, Ginger Rogers, an older sister. Doris gets killed at the end of the film by the Klan, and that's how the movie ends. And apparently there was such a drop in membership for the Ku Klux Klan, because if the Ku Klux Klan kills Doris Day, there's something wrong with the Klan. And that was a great point to prove.
What are one of the amazing things about her? There's so many amazing things, but certainly her health and her beauty that she's retained through the years. And she never really, and I think I read either her one of her early biographies, that she never really did any major exercises, just very few daily. Do you know if she still does those? Or?
Yeah, I mean, she's a big swimmer. I mean, she swam laps around the pool. She always took a lot of sun. And there's a misconception with Doris Day, the way she was filmed and the cameras. It was the lighting in the studio that really gave her that effect. And Norman Jewison, who directed her in her first movie with James Gardner, arrived on the set the first day, and he couldn't understand this lighting. It was like unbelievable, but Doris knew how to light herself, and she'd been working so many movies. So,
it wasn't the cameras, it was the lighting.
So he said, "My God, this is so bright, this is crazy." And then he looked in the camera, he says, "Oh my God, this looks beautiful." And Norman Jewison says that he learned so much from working with her, because it was really one of his first films. He had worked with Judy Garland on her television show, and Marty Melcher hired him because he knew he would be good working with a major star and could handle any problems. And Judy Garland was a problem a day, so that was really tough. But he directed that show the best he could for the time that it lasted.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about the Doris Day Show.
Mm-hmm.
It's the only show, I believe, in the history of television that changed formats every year. So could you break it down a little bit for us?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at shows today, they change formats every year. So you can almost look at it as that she wanted the show to evolve and have the life of a woman. And the show didn't change. The show actually only changed once drastically, because she was a mom. And she moved with her kids to San Francisco, got a job at Today's World. And it probably would have been a good idea if for the fourth season, there was a thing like 5 years later, where the kids are in college, and then there's a new boss.
Which they do a lot.
But at the time, they weren't thinking. And Doris wanted to move the show forward, and she wanted to be a reporter as opposed to just a secretary. Mm-hmm. And then she started traveling the world and fell in love with Peter Lawford, and all these different things happened. The show became a little more adult, and Jackie Joseph was terrific in it, and John Denner was great. And so the show really changed in the way the world was changing, and All in the Family and all these shows were on. And this was a very mature show, plus it was an expensive show. The sets were unbelievable. You know, the way they were done, I mean, they had two sets for it. It was big, it was huge, and it was filmed, and Doris bought everything. She was the executive producer on it. And the show really went from her living on a farm, moving to San Francisco, getting a job, because she stayed on the farm for 2 years, and then moving to San Francisco. She explains that in an episode, because the commute was too much. And she stayed in the same apartment. So the kids basically either went back with their grandfather, or they were older, and she was older, and knew people at the magazine. And that's really it. But people like to say, oh my God, it was different every year. I mean, Ellen was changing her show every year, you know? She was a wonderful, cool girl single. Boom, she's a lesbian. So it's kind of like it just changed, like, and the friends were changing, the name was changing. And that's okay, because that's how life is.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So,
like, you almost disagree with that.
No, that's not, I don't
disagree with that. All right, so tell us about the book. Give us a little breakdown on the book.
Okay, so the book features, it's a television show, but what we did is that at the end of every episode, we do some day facts that either goes back to her life or her career. An interesting day fact, for example, is one of the episodes from the first season, Doris does a family picture. And the little boys want to bring girls to be in the picture. It's a milk commercial. So one of the little boys brings a black girl as his best friend. And the photographer says, it can't be done, that won't work, blah, blah, blah. So even in 1968, there was a, and so that's a very controversial episode. Sure, sure. And Doris wanted to make sure this girl was included in the show. Now remember that Doris's stepmom was black. And you know, she had lived through this whole thing of her father being prejudiced and then falling in love with this woman that owned the bar that he bought, and then surprised Doris Day one day with that story. And that was such a thing that changed, and her father did this in the 50s, so that was really, and that, there's some episodes that are really, but she was so, she did it so subtly, and the censors at CBS and all that stuff, it was okay if Doris Day was doing it, you know?
Right.
And she was able to bring that in without Archie Bunker yelling, right, and that kind of a thing, and it was nice, and it became really exciting, and then she grew with that, and a lot of episodes would involve pollution and air change and animals and, you know, so it became kind of.
And yet it still remained family and cozy and likable. And,
yeah.
I mean, she
and
was
comfortable.
Like, yes. Yeah. But she, I think, and that's a word that we talk a lot about is the likability. Would you expand a little bit on the likability factor of Doris?
Yes. You know, what's interesting is that Doris got in 1968 into television. And a lot of movie stars were doing that. Henry Fonda got his own television show. James Stewart got his own television show. Debbie Reynolds got one. Lana Turner got one. And they all bombed. People felt really comfortable with Doris Day in their homes. Those movie stars, just for some reason, didn't resonate for television ratings. Henry Fonda was not good doing a sitcom.
It was the Smith Family, right?
Yeah, exactly. So it just didn't really, people didn't like that. They just didn't want to see that. Rock Hudson did good on television with Nick Miller and Wife.
Sure, sure.
So it's funny because those two people really resonated well on television and people felt comfortable having them in their home. And Doris was a staple of Monday nights on CBS right after Lucy. And, you know, and after 5 years, her contract was done. They wanted her to stay.
And oh, they did. So
oh, yeah, they wanted her.
So the ratings were still.
The ratings were great. And CBS, as a matter of fact, they were offered Monday Night Football. And that's the cover of a TV Guide cover where it says, what, and cancel Doris Day?
Huh.
So, you know, so basically, no, it was, Mary Tyler was on the cover, so that's the title of the TV Guide. But anyway, no, she was very important. And she says, you know, I've done everything I wanted to do with this character in the show. She wanted to do something else. And she didn't do anything else for a long time. Like, she did a special in 1975, Doris Day Today. And then
the Christmas special too, or no?
No, she did the Doris Day special, or Doris Marianne Kappelhoff in 71, which is amazing, with Tony Bennett and Rock Hudson a little bit. And the last one was with John Denver, Tim Conway, and Rich Little. So that's all available on DVD. Not that I'm selling.
Now, do you cover all of that in the book?
Yes. So that's all that's covered, and how they were made and produced and all that stuff.
And she granted interviews for this book as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So this has exclusive. And she even called a book party, and she loved the book. There were so many books that were coming out on Doris Day during that period, and she was very upset about, there was one coming out that came out on Virgin, and different books were coming out, and she never wanted to grant interviews or anything like that. But this one was like, and I'm not talking about anything that's, I'm not a person, it's her career, it's fun. There's little anecdotes about her life, but the only thing that's kind of cool and interesting, there's the Mad Magazine comic book that they did on her. Mm-hmm. So I bought the rights to that, and that's in the book, and it's really fun because it's the only time you see Doris in comic book form, so it's kind of cool. And she becomes a superhero woman at the end, so it's fun.
Cool.
Pierre, thank you so
much. You're welcome. I talked so long.
No, you did not. It was perfect. I want to say, will you stick around for the panel?
Sure, absolutely.
Have a nice hand, Pierre Patrick, everyone. Okay, my next guest is a super fan of Doris Day, and I believe he has some...
I have some items.
It's all legal, right?
It's all legal.
Okay.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dan Tierman.
Hello. Thank you. It's interesting, but it's legal.
So how are you? How did you become interested in Doris Day?
Well,
I
don't know. I was never not interested in Doris Day. A friend of mine had me come up with him to Carmel about 11 years ago for her birthday. And we discovered a bunch of people at the Cypress Inn also celebrating her birthday. And there was a radio call-in show. We could say hi to Doris over the radio and all that. And then we ended up calling the Cypress Inn, and we found these people. And we ended up having the big birthday dinner with them at the Cypress Inn and Terry's Lounge. And this man sitting next to me turned to me and said, "When did you first know?" And I didn't know how to answer that because I said she was always just there. She was always there. I never didn't know. So
well, that could have meant anything. The answer,
right?
Could have
I know, was a very cryptic question.
You won't be getting any of those tonight, either.
I've always loved her, and as a little boy, I watched the Doris Day Show and any movie with Six You Get Egg Roll. It's just something you're brought up with, and it's family. She's part of your family from, before you were born, practically. So she's always just been part of my life, really, just like so many of the things you're writing about, like a Bewitched kind of thing. They're just part of us. They're part of our experience.
Absolutely.
Okay, what did you bring with us?
Well, we had every year for these dinners, this one gentleman would put together books based on the theme. We'd have a different theme every year. This was the year we had the pajama game theme. And this gentleman, Lloyd, his name is, he just put together these massive books with every single detail about that film. Mm-hmm. So that was one. Then we had Calamity Jane year. So we have a whole book about all the, I'll just show you one. All the pictures, all the stills, everything about Calamity Jane. I mean, he's really the one who should be here being interviewed. The length of time, the amount of work he put in every single year. And decorated the rooms with just beautiful, just tremendous amount of time and love. Mm-hmm. Because they just love this lady. So we had Jumbo year. So my favorite, of course, Pillow Talk. Yeah. So we had one year, it was the 50th anniversary of Pillow Talk, I think.
Put these books out for everybody in attendance?
Later on, everyone who went, he would mail it to us. Yeah, and he's a super, super, super fan.
I can't see me doing that for the Legend of Lizzie Borden for Lizzie Borden.
Well, it is hard to imagine, really, but he really puts together And so, I think I have one more. Oh, this was the Love Me or Leave Me year. So it's quite beautiful, really. You know, so I've saved them all. And I've written to her every year and sent her little gifts every year. And she's just a wonderful, wonderful human being.
So what is it about Doris Day? I mean, from your perspective. Adding to what Pierre has already said or to what...
I think what he says is absolutely true. There is something, there's just something extra, there's a great kindness about her. You know, she's a loving, she's very connected to the animal world. She has a certain type of understanding. She's not really, I don't think she's that impressed with herself. She knows she's good, because how could she not know it? But
There seems to be a real sense of humility about her.
Yeah, she sees the big picture, I think, you know.
How has she managed to retain such a down-to-earthness, which is also a big phrase here on Throwback Thursdays, really unaffected by Hollywood, never really, at least this is my sense of it, never really thinking she was better than anyone, never really feeling that her money or her position made her better. How does someone retain that in the glitter where it can be a very plastic world?
I think she really does that because she really is so connected to nature, you know, to animals. She has really psychic, telepathic connection with other things, the bigger things, the more important things. And she knows her work is great, and it's one. And so I think people connect with that. They feel it. And so these people, you know, some of these fans that come up, they travel far and wide. And it's because they feel a very personal, intimate connection to her. Like they really, truly believe that she has helped them survive.
And I found that with Elizabeth Montgomery as well.
I think it's very true of people like that, you know.
Not every performer.
No.
Very, very special in particular. What do you have there?
Oh, this is...
It's a letter from her?
Well, one of the first years I went up there, the singer Anita O'Day had just passed away. She was a great jazz singer, if people don't remember her, but from the big band era. So I left a gift for Doris, and I wrote that, you know, Anita really liked her very much, and this was in remembering Anita. I don't think she quite knew that Anita died, but she sent this very nice handwritten note. This is just kind of an example of how she thinks of other people. She wrote, "Dear Daniel, thank you for thinking of me on my birthday. It was so nice to hear from you and Anita. I hope that she's feeling well and feeling happy." Unfortunately, she was gone. But it was sweet of her to say this. You know, she didn't know. But she said, "It was so sweet of her to remember the four leggers, and I appreciate her gift. Please, when you see her, say hi and God bless. I'll never forget her fabulous voice. Love to you both, Doris." And I thought that was just, you know, kind of an example of how she is.
Well, you are an example too of keen into that kindness about her, and you probably, there was a piece of you that you saw in her, and probably a piece of her that she saw in you. So,
well, thank you.
People get together.
Yeah.
They notice very recognizable aspects of one another.
I think you feel a kindred spirit.
Yes.
With people, certain people, you know.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Will you stick around for the panel?
Absolutely.
All right.
Thanks.
Have a nice hand. Dan Turman. Our next guest, it's a very special guest. She's going to be performing for us tonight. We're going to have a little music. She was Doris's secretary during the Doris Day show, which, if I haven't mentioned already, is one of my favorite shows ever. How many times am I going to say it? So we're so honored to have her, so delighted that she'll be performing. Ladies and gentlemen, Judy Lampoo.
Which mic did I use? This is it? Oh, thank you. Hello. Okay. Now the reason I do this song, Secret Love, she once said it was her favorite song of all the songs she'd recorded. Anyway, it's one of my favorites. I was going to do a one-woman show of all the best of Doris Day, my late husband's idea. He wanted to produce it because I had anecdotes to tell between the songs since I'd worked for her all during the Doris Day show. So he thought, what a great idea. Let's do a one-woman Doris Day show, and you can sing her songs and tell your little stories that you know about Doris. And I thought, that was a cool idea. So the first track I got together was Secret Love, and I started performing it. And I performed it a bunch of times because I participated in the Miss Senior California, Miss Senior America pageants. I'm a senior, in case you couldn't tell. So I haven't sung for a while, but I think it'll be okay. And let me see if I remember what we're doing here. Okay, it's off, power on, disc two, and play. Hopefully it works. I hit play, come on.
There it is.
A secret love and lived within the heart of me. All too soon, my secret love came impatient to be free. So I told a friendly star dreamers often do, just how wonderful you are, and why I'm so in love with you.
Wasn't it great? Another hand. So, were you singing on the set of the Doris
Station? No, not I wasn't doing that. Doris, in fact, one day I was driving her somewhere, and she said, I forget how it came up, but she asked me where was my favorite place to be, and I said in a recording studio, and she was shocked. She didn't know I did anything with music. I really didn't... I was very professional. I never told her what my aspirations, my dreams, what I wanted to do. I was her secretary. I did everything for her that she needed done, and I kept it separate, you know.
How did you get the job? You remember the...
I do, yeah. I was working for Procter & Gamble Productions, and they were the sponsor. and it was in Hollywood, and I worked there for 3 years. I worked for George Giroux and Dave Lawrence. Each in turn was president of the Television Academy. So I got to go to all the Television Academy balls, and I got to see Johnny Carson and Carol Burnett and Sammy Davis Jr. and Buddy Hackett and Lucille Ball. I got them all, they were all honored, and I got to be there and dress in a gown and have dinner with all the stars, and I just thought that was so cool.
Awesome.
What are some of your favorite moments behind the scenes, or any anecdotes that you might have from the show?
The opening of my story with Doris is really a crazy one. When I worked for Procter & Gamble Productions, I got to know the secretary to the producer. Her name was Madeline Schreier. And she told me that there was an opening, that Doris Day was going to need a secretary. And I said, oh, I'd love to do it. So I went over and interviewed. And I wasn't working just for her. I was working for her, for Terry, and for Don Genson, who was one of the casting people. And he also was in charge of the scoring sessions. And
Her son was a producer, right?
Terry Melcher, right. He produced the Yardbirds and a bunch of people. And Billy James, I think, was one of his partners. He was a well-known music producer, too. And it was Arwen Productions, but she also had all her publishing companies. There were four of them, I think. And I wound up learning so much there because I worked for Don Genson, who did much of the casting. He did the breakdown. I had to do the breakdowns, call Jimmy Haskell, who set up the scoring sessions with a full orchestra for all the shows. They scored with a full orchestra. So I got to set up the scoring sessions. I did the contracts for the day players. I did all the contracts for the publishing. And I worked for Don Genson. I worked for Terry. I worked for Doris. But whenever Doris needed me, I dropped everything else and ran to her. So I should have been getting several salaries.
Sure.
But the day of my opening day on that job, there were plainclothes detectives running all over the place. And I thought, what the heck, you know, is going on? And it was the day after the night of the Manson killings. Mm-hmm. And Terry Melcher was the target. And luckily, he didn't live in that house anymore. But these detectives were all over the place, so it was kind of a crazy day for my start. Mm-hmm. And I had an unfortunate other connection to the other family that were killed by the Manson group. It was the LaBianco family. Mm-hmm. And my aunt and uncle were very close friends with them, so it was not a nice way to begin the job, but it worked out. Now, unfortunately, Don Genson, who was the guy I worked with on a regular basis and stopped whenever she needed me, he wasn't very nice. He was very difficult. And I don't think he was doing things that Doris would have approved of, and I just couldn't tell anybody. I just had to ride that fence, you know? I kept my mouth shut, did my best for everybody, and never told her. I never was able to tell her. I didn't know if I should or if I could or what would happen, so. Anyway.
So you had a lot of discretion. I mean, and that's what kept you there.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of people don't understand, whatever your job, whether it's Hollywood or accounting, discretion is so important. It is, what's that saying, discretion is the better part of valor?
Right, right.
So true.
But she was very interesting. Another little known fact probably is she had me learn her signature, and I'm very sorry to say I did a lot of autographs. So if you got an autograph from Doris, you couldn't be sure, because I really could nail her signature. And she knew it, too. She approved. But
maybe you can sign it in Pierre's book tonight.
I don't know if I even remember it, you know? That's the only time
but just us.
That's the only forgery I ever did, and it was with the approval. But anyway, I had a lot of fun there. If she called me, I dropped everything. And I remember the Ellenson and Paul were the head writers, and they their secretary didn't like me. So I kept my distance. One day she wore hot pants to work, and I went, we can wear hot pants to work? Wow. My father was a knitwear manufacturer, and he made knitted ones, so they were clingy. So I wore hot pants to work, and Abby Singer was our production manager. And he took one look at me and said, you're not going down to the set. Not dressed like that, you're not. And I said, why? Valerie wears hot pants. You're not going down to the set, he said. So I'm sitting at my desk and Doris calls me down to the set. Come on down, I want to dictate. I said, I can't come down. Why? I told her, you cut your butt down here, she said. So I went down to the set and she said, oh, I love it. Can I have an outfit just like that? I got her one just like it. My father made her one too. She was very cool.
And she had hot legs as well.
She was great.
I mean, she had one heck of a butt.
She did exercise. She rode her bike all the time. She rode her bike all over Beverly Hills and collected
in disguise or
no, and she'd collect all the stray dogs, and she'd go yell and lecture all the neighbors who were not keeping their dogs under control. She was just all over the place rounding them up.
Now, we talked a little bit about this in the pre-interview, but someone on the set had actually asked you out, or did you want to address that?
Several people asked me out, but the most well-known one was McLean Stevenson, and he kept on hitting on me, and I kept saying no. And finally, when I said I might go with him, I met the guy I was about to marry, and then I didn't go.
Oh, so I thought you did, but you never actually went.
I don't think I ever went. If I did, I really can't remember, but...
So did you all have, like, holiday parties, or was it just a wrap party, or what?
Yeah, nothing. I don't think we had any huge celebrations that I recall. I really don't recall that.
What was the name of the actor who played her father?
Denver Powell.
Denver Powell on the farm.
Right. So, but he was there for like a season, two seasons.
Yeah, right.
What was he like? And he was not much older than
yeah,
than Doris.
Yeah, but he was the white hair and the beard.
He looked it. But I think he was only like 5 years.
2 years.
2 years. Yeah. How about that?
But he was a really great guy. I used to see him all the time and running up and down the streets in like Toluca Lake. He hung out with Barris. Is that the name of the custom car guy?
George
Barris. He used to hang out with George Barris all the time. He was in the car.
The Gong Show?
No, this guy was...
The Batmobile.
Yeah, this is the guy that made all the fancy cars. Denver Pyle used to like to hang out around his... I'd see him in the area all the time because he was in the cars. He liked that old those crazy cars.
And then, of course, Doris had two children on the show, and one, unfortunately, died in a tragic accident very young. And the other, what's his name?
Philip Brown.
He is still working today.
Yeah, he does tons of commercials.
Tons of commercials. So that's nice to know that, you know, like a lot of child stars, you know, they grew up on these shows. They have all this attention for five seasons or whatever. And, you know, they're told that they're beautiful and that people love them 24 hours a day. And then when the show is over, you know, there's no esteem that's based on any truth in of a reality.
Well, that happens to a lot of the performers today. Look at people like Justin Bieber, you know. All of a sudden, they make it big, and it goes to their head, and they get crazy, and they act out, you know.
Right. Is he here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Justin. Miley Cyrus.
Yeah.
And I think that's why he cried when he performed at the Grammys. He didn't expect all that adulation and that love. He got a standing ovation.
Well, everybody will give you a second chance if you're sincere.
Exactly.
You know.
Exactly.
Now, Terry used to always try to fix me up. He used to tell me, he told me he was going to fix me up with somebody who was well-healed. And do you know that I did not know what that meant? I did not know. I was in my 20s. I don't know why I'd never heard the expression, but I really didn't. I thought, well healed. I couldn't even ask him. I was too embarrassed. What does that mean? Is he talking about heels? You know? I never did have a clue, and he never did actually fix me up. But he did.
So what's it mean? Okay.
Rich.
Okay. Oh, well, I see.
Right. Yeah, he was tired of me dating guys that didn't have a lot. And, you know, I did my own thing. I wasn't interested. But they did do something to me I wasn't happy about. I was told to deliver an envelope to Terry, who was hanging out with Sly and the Family Stone. And I was a secretary. I wasn't a delivery person. Mm-hmm. And they gave me this envelope and told me not to look in it.
Okay, now we are taping this.
I don't care. Okay. Terry, first of all, sadly, Terry is no longer with us. So, you know. And Doris had no part of this, so it had nothing to do with her. But I, of course, looked in the envelope.
And?
And it said, don't look in the envelope.
It said $75,000 in cash. And I delivered it, and I went back to the work.
I would have left.
And I told somebody that needed to hear it never to send me on such an errand again. I said, that's dangerous. I'm not doing stuff like that. If you want something like that done, you hire a messenger service. I'm not doing it. And it was really on the Doris Day Show, not because of Doris, but because of Don Genson, that I learned to stand up for myself. I was working my ass off. I worked so hard. I did everything there was to do. I did it well. And Don Genson used to lose everything I gave him. And I learned to make four copies of everything, so when he asked me for it, I could have it. Then when he wasn't around, I'd dig on through his desk and I'd find him, you know? He was really a pain in the ass, he really was. And one day, my boyfriend came to take me to lunch, and Doris had called me to take letters. So I was in there taking a letter, and Don told him to leave. He was there with my car to do, he told him to leave. When I came out, I threw such a tantrum. I threw a tantrum, never before. I was sweet and kind and gentle.
Which you are today.
But I wasn't then. And they never forgot it. And I was treated so great after that. I learned the lesson. You know what? You stand up for yourself,
well,
you show them you've got teeth, and people will treat you better.
Well, people treat you as you feel that you are worthy of being treated.
I must have decided I was worthy.
Well, we're certainly glad that you showed up tonight.
I want to talk about Cosmo.
Oh, okay, Cosmo.
Remember, I told you. Coalition of Songwriter and Music Organizations.
Oh, yes. You're a nonprofit.
My late husband and I had started a 501c3, and I'm going to finish it because we put on all kinds of events to help all kinds of people in the music industry. We would do something called Pitch a Song, where we get music supervisors on a panel. You could make connections, you could place your songs, you could get them in television and movies and stuff like that. This was on a small, intimate basis that you couldn't do any other way. There are all kinds of organizations that do it that are huge, and you never connect with anybody. But we fixed it so you could. And that's only one of the things that we did. And so I'm going to resume, and I'm going to continue doing that, because that was my late husband Steve's wish, and
fantastic.
We're going to do it. Joel knows. He was good friends with Steve. That's how I met Joel. And we had a really good time, and we did a lot of good work in town. We're going to do more of it.
Wonderful. Let's have a nice hand. Judy Landry. Gentlemen, would you join us, please, here on the panel? We are now going to take Q&A. Pierre Patrick?
I guess.
You need more
Okay.
Mics.
Yeah, I think we're good here.
You need more mics, right?
You pick up one over there. Right there, bud. On the floor.
Oh, thanks. Oh, I see.
So we're going to bump up the lights.
Oh. How about that? Oh, thank you.
We bumped up more. I just love saying that. All right. Does anybody have any questions for here for anyone on the panel? Yes, sir.
It's actually a two-part question. First off, Judy, you made a reference almost to passing to a great individual, and that's Abby Singer.
Yeah.
Who went on from doing Doris Day to working for Mary Tyler Moore in, during the MGM era. It's like his name was in the credits as executive in charge of production for Mary Tyler Moore, Rhoda, Hill Street Blues, and the list goes on.
Yeah.
And maybe you can talk a little bit about him. But secondly, as successful as the Doris Day show was, is the story true that the deal was actually made between Martin Milcher, her husband, and CBS without her even knowing about it?
Yeah, and after Marty died, she needed the money, and Terry told her she had to do it.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't want to do it.
Yeah.
You probably know something about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little more complicated than that, is that she was doing With Six You Get Egg Rolls, which was her last movie. During that whole thing, she was so busy shooting that Marty was getting the TV show ready, and he didn't want her to do The Graduate or anything like that. And TV was the way to go, and CBS made a contract that was unbelievable, more than that, millions of dollars. So she decided to do the show, and after all, you know, everything was said and done, he passed away, and she was stuck with the contract, and she said, okay, let's do it. The sets were already built. Fran Ryan was already hired, most of the actors, so she, it was a tough year for her the first year. But she went with it and did it anyway. So
now there didn't seem that much of a. You turned
it off, I think.
Try now. Yeah. Turn the lights on. There you go.
The hat. Kind of really good. Yeah, it went off. You must have accidentally.
Do you want to use this one?
Here, try it now.
Oh. One, whatever.
No.
There didn't seem to be that much of a chemistry between her and Fran Ryan. Was that true, or did it not? Did she not see that there was anything, and or did she see that there wasn't, and she and Fran left the show?
No.
Well, were you there when Fran Ryan was working? You were there later, right?
I think I started later.
Yeah. See, Fran Ryan only did. She was hired for the series, but she ended up doing 10 episodes, and it was a time when CBS was changing. They wanted a multi-ethnic thing for the show, so they hired Naomi Stevens to just do an Hispanic maid and give the show a little more flavor. And Fran Ryan wanted more lines all the time. She was funny, she was good, and sometimes they just gave her a little scene and she was taking more and more of the show. And, you know, I mean, she was known as Arnold Ziffel's mother. So, you know, I mean, when you've been raising a pig, it's from a different kind of thing that you're doing. So, no, she was let go, and that's what happened with that. So.
About Abby Singer, wanted to hear about that.
Sure.
Well, Abby was just the coolest guy. It was really weird because people thought that I was related. They thought that I might have been his daughter. We didn't know how that got started, and we couldn't convince people it wasn't true. I don't know why that happened. I think it may have been because I think he may have adopted a daughter from Vista Del Mar, and I had lived there. So I think that's how that happened. Anyway, he was really, really a great guy. He could teach anybody everything that you needed to know about the business. In fact, he was extremely great when the man that I married was a professional motocross racer, and when he retired, he needed a job, and Abby got him into prop making. He got him in right away. He got offered two jobs almost instantly because Abby referred him, and he wound up spending 20 years in the business, made a great living. Abby was just the greatest guy. He knew everything there was to know about the business, and he'd help you, and he'd give you anything, and just loved him to death.
And Judy, I forgot to mention that you were a writer, and you did episodes of, like, Columbo, correct?
Yeah, my partner and I wrote a two-hour Columbo movie of the week. And that got us into the Writers Guild, and we worked.
But you never did McMillan and Wife.
No.
This was after, right?
This was after.
We were talking beforehand that when the show, when Columbo and McMillan and Wife, whatever, were released on DVD, they left out the opening with the music and, you know, the guy with the flashlight, and, you know, people were upset with that because they want. That's one of the things they remembered about that show, and sure enough, they re-released it on DVD with that opening, because that's what you connect with. When you make a connection with 50 billion people on a TV show, and you just can't go change it, that's why a lot of these remakes that they do fail, because they try to recreate something instead of respect the original mythology of the original product. But that's a whole other show. Okay, any other questions?
But Herbie, you didn't say who was the composer of the NBC mystery movie thing.
Who was the composer, Brett?
Henry Mancini.
Oh, Henry Mancini.
And what was the recurring three notes throughout that whole thing?
Do re mi.
You're close. You should know as a former NBC page. Bong,
bong, oh, jeez, okay. Yeah, thanks, Brad, for bringing all of that to everybody's attention.
It was all done with a flute.
Wow, that's awesome. Thank you, Brad.
You're welcome.
Okay, any other questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
I know I'm on the panel, but I have a question. I keep, for years now, I've been hearing on Facebook, and someone sent me an email, get Doris Day the Oscar, Academy Award. I've always wondered, since you know Doris so well, is that something that she would like, or does it have any...
No, I mean, she doesn't really care necessarily about awards or anything like that. And the Academy is insistent on you have to pick it up yourself.
Yeah.
But Jean-Louis Trintignant didn't pick it up himself, and a few people didn't pick it up themselves. Well, that has this is a Lifetime Achievement Award. So, there's no reason for the Academy not to give it to her, except that they don't want to. So, and you can write and call them and this and that, whatever.
A lot of people want them to.
Yeah, I mean, it would make her fans, I think, very happy, but she herself...
Why does the Academy not want to?
I don't know. I think it's a good question for, you know? You have the answer?
I don't know
if I have the answer to that, but I know that with Elizabeth Montgomery, she was nominated several times for Bewitched, and the show was not a simple little fantasy show. Anyone who really understands the show or read my books realizes that it was very well done, and many of those shows in the 60s were well done. But with regard to Elizabeth, she, like Susan Lucci, by the way, was nominated several times, but ultimately never won, although I think Susan did finally win. But, you know, Elizabeth Montgomery was gorgeous. She was down to earth. She had a beautiful personality. Her parents were very prestigious. Robert Montgomery and Elizabeth Allen were, you know, stars in their own right. And, you know, peers are sometimes odd people. You know, there's, well, she has everything. We're not going to give her an award, too. So there might have been some of that with Doris. She had everything. You know, and it's, and sometimes these award shows are not necessarily popularity contests as much as political. Very political. So that's my take on it.
But she deserved it for Love Me or Leave Me. Love Me or Leave Me. I couldn't believe everybody got nominated but her. And she was great in it.
I mean, you have to remember a few years ago, Oprah Winfrey got the Oscar. And that was only after doing Color Purple. She got a Lifetime Achievement Award Oscar. So that was only one movie, and, you know, the Academy, she gave a nice amount of money, and whatever, something happened. Is this on film now?
Yes.
Is Oprah watching? But anyway, no, it's just that they should do it. I mean, it's common sense. She's got the Golden Globe.
Well, also, too, I mean, there's, you know,
award shows today have been so diluted. You know, there's an award for everything. I liked it when there was only the Oscars, the Grammys, the Tonys, the Emmys. That was it, you know, so.
But I'll tell you something funny. When she got the Presidential Medal of Freedom, that award she really loved. It was delivered in a plane to her. She didn't go to Washington, even though they wanted her to have the Lincoln Room ready for her. She wore it to lunch at Quail Lodge on her neck. And it was like really, she was really, really proud of that. And that's something, and that is the Presidential Medal of Freedom. So that's really, really nice.
Well, all of you have been really, really nice, and it's been so lovely to have you. And thank you for taking time out this evening to celebrate.
I think he's had a question for Pierre.
Oh, I'm sorry. Hold
my staff.
Yes, sir.
Oh, thank you. Pierre, do you think Doris would come to L.A. to get the Oscar?
Oh no, I don't think so.
Okay.
You know, I mean, it's not. But the thing is, there could have been a film thing or. You know, when she got the LA Film Critics Awards, Norman Jewison picked it up, and he had a phone call with Doris live. And, you know, things like that can be arranged if the Academy wanted to make an effort. You know, but they don't want to, and that's...
How many Oscars was she nominated for?
She was only nominated for one, for Pillow Talk, but she got 6 Oscar nominations for her songs, and that was before the Grammys, and she did win for Que Sera Sera and Secret Love. But It's Magic was nominated, even Julie was nominated, a song from Love Me or Leave Me was nominated. So, but she did, she, you know, in a sense, she's got one for Que Sera Sera and Secret Love. So if you want to look at it that way.
So maybe you can put it out, talk to Doris and say if you come.
No, well, why don't we ask her?
Yeah.
All right, any other questions you might have, you can, we'll all be over here and you can ask everyone individually. Thank you so much, everyone. Let's get over to the table. Have Pierre sit and sign some books for you all. And next week we have Kathy Coleman from Land of the Lost, one of my favorites.